All right, Shalom, all praise to Yahweh, Bashem Yahushua. It's your brother Yashar Moth, coming at you again with a couple more scripts. Just want to go into a quick little topic. May take a couple more minutes than a few, so we'll just go about it all through the spirit and power of Yahweh, Bashem Yahushua. This is Ecclesiasticus, chapter 25, verse 1. In three things I was beautified, and stood up and beautiful both before the Most High and men. The unity of brethren, the love of neighbors, a man and a wife that agree together. Three sorts of men my soul hateth, and I am greatly offended at their life. A poor man that is proud, a rich man that is a liar, and an old adulterer that doteth. So like I said, all praise to Yahweh, Bashem Yahushua. And the lesson that I wanted to go into was going into the unity amongst the nation of Israel. And we know that there are definitely those who are contrary to unity, and those are the wicked, are those who are in a sleep and a retarded, a slowed down, or reversed mind state. Because the whole reason why the Most High created us as a nation was for us to be in unison and for us to serve Him in unity, and for our community to be better than all the other nations. But because we were rebellious people and a peculiar nation who don't want to do the will of the Heavenly Father, the creator of the whole universe, the highest power ever out there, the Most High has caused us to be in a confused state and to lack the leadership and the unity that will cause us to be a great people. So that was one of the things that was stripped of us. That's why you see us in the state that we're in now, is because of our mistakes and things we did in the past that created our current situation. So we know that the Most High doesn't frown on unison, our family, our togetherness. Now, what's contrary to the understanding of that is what men have took and twisted the understanding on when Yahweh Shai said that He came to set a sword and to pretty much cause division. And with that division that He was going to cause was the division on truth and wickedness. He was the truth, and He was cutting through all the lies and everything and setting up that standard. And so everybody who was against that, pretty much there would be in division. So the nation of Israel coming together as a whole is not a bad thing if we're coming together under Yahweh Bashem Yahushua. But we know until the Lord is sent for that second coming, then we're not going to have that unity, that perfect unity. But until that time, we're supposed to be rehearsing the righteous acts and working on that unity. So brothers, with all the fighting and going back and forth, it's counterproductive. And you know, brothers see me sling mud and play around a little bit on the comment board, but overall, that's not my mission. That's not me and my brother's mission. That's not the mission of true men of the Lord. We want to see our circumstances and our situation change. Exposing these cults and these gangs and groups are necessary, is something that we have to do. But as far as being petty and being childish, I don't want to play no parts in that anymore. So what I'll do is I'll shape up and do what I'm supposed to do, and that's to be a leader amongst our people. Because our people lack leadership. And you hear a lot of these lost brothers and sisters out here, when you challenge the false leadership that they're underneath, or when you challenge the false prophets that a lot of men and women follow, the first thing they want to do is get mad. But then they want to ask, well, who are we going to follow? And as leaders of the nation of Israel, all of the brothers and sisters out there in the leadership spirit, we're supposed to point them to the answer, which is Yahweh and His Son, Yahweh Shai. Follow them. Don't follow men. You got a lot of men that put men over them, and that's caused them to err and to go into a dark state of confusion, fear, darkness, lack of understanding. And this is all because they've appointed leadership over them that is satanic in nature on many different fronts and on every level. Like the scriptures say, there shall arise many false Christs and false prophets confessing and professing the name of the Lord, but they're coming like wolves. So the true men of the Lord, man, we got to stand up and be that standard and promote what needs to be promoted, which is mainly the gospel. Prophecies are going to come because prophecies were spoken about, so we're supposed to bring those out. But the main thing that Yahweh Shai and his disciples were implementing was salvation. And to receive salvation, we have to preach the gospel, which is the good news and the things that are will help a person become meat for salvation. So let me go ahead and get into the scriptures so it's not just like I'm babbling and rambling on. You know, Jake can do that. Go to Matthew's 18. Matthew's 18 and 19. This is Matthew's 18 and 19. It says, "Again, I say unto you, that if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, there I am in the midst of them." And that's Yahweh Shai telling us that, you know, when you got brothers in the spirit together in that unison, in that unity, the Spirit of the Most High is with us as long as we come in correctly and we're in righteousness. And when Yahweh Shai is dealing with you, there's nothing that you can't obtain, there's nothing that you can't do, and there's nothing that you can't conquer. So we're better together than apart. Because like the scriptures say, two or three are gathered in my name, there I am. So brothers have to be in unity. And we know that everybody's not going to agree, but we have to work towards that. That's the goal. And for the brothers that don't want to be in that spirit, well, you, in fact, are the terrorists. And the Most High has put that spirit of being anti-Israel, anti-Christ on you. And that's why you feel the passion that you feel about being separate. It's the same thing with the Pharisees and Sadducees back in ancient time. They wanted to be separate because they felt like they were the Most High's favorites when the whole time they wasn't getting it right. The Most High wasn't dealing with them. This is 1 Corinthians 1 and 10. It says, "Now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord, Yahweh Shai HaMashiach, who the world calls Jesus Christ, that ye all speak the same thing, and that there be no divisions among you, but that ye be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment." And the Heavenly Father honors our unity. It's not like he's all about the division. The division is going to come between the wheat and the tare, between the righteous and the wicked. And that's a natural thing. There has to be a separation between the light and the dark. That's just the way it's all set up, the order of things. The Most High is all about order and dealing in order. And that's why he made the sheep and he made the goats. They perform differently. They have different tasks and they're in two different mind states. But the body of Yahweh Shai, which is the 1/3 and the 144 who are the elect, the chosen, the remnant, Yahweh Bashem Yahshai, and innumerable people. Got these guys and so-called leaders always want to talk about a small sanctuary. But that sanctuary is actually a great multitude. So pushing people away from the truth is counterproductive. You should be trying to bring all in, like the scriptures talk about, bringing them into the marriage. And those who ain't properly adorned in the correct attire, they're going to be kicked out when that time comes. But we in the time of edifying and building, being constructive. And a lot of brothers are in the spirit of Satan, being destructive. You showing a brother love and all he wants to do in return is show you hate. But the scriptures tell you to bless them that curse you and try to come against you. Bless them, meaning stay in the spirit and do the will of the Heavenly Father and show them that love and that mercy, because the Most High is going to give them their payout. A wicked man is going to receive that just reward for being a wicked man. This is Malachi 2 and... Hold on. It's Malachi 2 and 10. Malachi 2 and 10 says, "Have we not all one Father? Have not one power created us? Why do we deal treacherously every man against his brother? by profaning the covenant of our fathers. And that's what brothers are doing today. Still to this day, dealing treacherously against each other. Always in a spirit of cussing the next nigga out. You a coon, you a nigger, you a nigga. When the Most High, He put us in captivity, so our enemies did that to us. So we would get that sense of unity and being tired of people coming against us. But brothers is always in that divisive, deconstructive spirit. They always want to deconstruct something. That's the spirit of the Antichrist. That's the spirit of Satan. The spirit of division, the spirit of malice, hate. Loathing one another for no reason instead of loving one another. It's way easier to hate a brother. This is Psalms 133. Psalms 133 and 1. It says, "Behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It is like a precious ointment upon the head that ran down upon the beard, even Aaron's beard that went down to the skirts of his garments, as the dew of Hermon, and as the dew that descended upon the mountains of Zion. For there the Lord commanded the blessing, even life evermore." The Most High is pleased when we're in unison, praising Him in righteousness and in order. But if you got shepherds out there scattering the sheep, then brothers ain't gonna be able to come together and do the right thing. There's always gonna be fighting, infighting, and beefing and warring going on. And that's why you see Israel in this current state, is because brothers are in that spirit of division. We're not supposed to be in that spirit of division. Those who don't want to get along with the program, they're gonna be weeded out and fall by the wayside. But being in the correct spirit, ruling over your spirit, and making sure you're in the right spirit is ideal. This is Matthew 23 and 8. Matthew 23 and 8. Hold on. Matthew 23 and 8 says, "But be not ye called Rabbi, for one is your master, even Christ," or Hamashiach, "and all ye are brethren. And call no man your father upon the earth, for one is your Father which is in heaven." And so we know that we have one Father. And for those, the goats, they have another Father. The Spirit, the scriptures say, "Ye are of your father the devil." So when you got men and women saying that we have another spiritual father, then they must be serving the devil, because we only have one Father on earth and in the spirit. And the Lord set that up, and He wrote this in the scriptures for our learning, for us to understand that, and for us not to become children of fools and children of wicked men, children of Satan. And you see a lot of the congregation of Israel has chosen to elect men as their king and as their Lord and as their master, instead of the Heavenly Father through His Son. And that's why you see them in the utter darkness that they're in. And it's clear. 2016, you have a lot of the congregation of Israel that's stone cold crazy out of their mind. In a cult-like mind state, instead of being in the mind state of a disciple and a follower of Yahweh Shai. And we know that the word cult just means to worship. But who and what are you worshiping? Are you worshiping the Father in spirit and truth? Are you worshiping men? You're worshiping yourself. You're worshiping false gods. You're worshiping mammon. What are you worshiping? What cult are you a part of? That's the question. A lot of brothers have cognitive dissonance, so they don't want to ask themselves these questions. These are questions that a lot of brothers don't take the opportunity to question themselves. That's why they go into these cults for years and years and lack the understanding that the Most High has for them. This is 1 John 5 and 1. 1 John 5 and 1. "Whosoever believeth that Yahweh Shai is the Christ," or the Hamashiach, "is born of the Most High. And everyone that loveth Him, that begat loveth him also that is begotten of him. And so that's how you know who your family is in this thing and who the body is. And because you got a lot of guys that saying the body is only pertaining to this group or this sect or this denomination or affiliation. But the body is actually a scattered people. We everywhere. The believers of the Lord are everywhere. And most of them didn't have to be trained by no man or taught by no man. These scriptures vibrated in their spirit and they knew. Once they heard the word, they knew. The Most High sealed them at that very second. So it didn't take a man necessarily for them to learn these words. Not saying that the men that wrote these books wasn't men. But I'm saying as far as a preacher or a minister, a lot of brothers and sisters woke up just off the spirit of hearing those words that came out of this book. So if any man is trying to take credit for that, I would be wary of that man. Says, by this we know that we love the children of the Most High when we love the Most High and keep His commandments. And like I always bring out in Matthew's, when it tells you the two greatest commandments, loving the Lord, not having no gods before Him, not worshiping no gods, and loving your brother and treat him just like yourself. So those are the two main commandments. Following the Ten Commandments, pretty much those two commandments, you fulfill them all. Got these guys hung up on the law, keeping you in the old Mosaic ways and not in the new covenant. They don't understand the difference in covenants. A lot of these brothers and sisters lack understanding, man. And that's because there's no unity in the body, and so the certain parts of the body ain't being fed and watered. It's not growing. Certain parts of the body are dying off. Certain parts of the body have been attached and adopted to different bodies. You saying you got a different head other than Hamashiach Yahushua, well, you're not attached to the body. You gotta be re-adopted. You gotta come into the that second covenant. The Most High has to bring you in. He has to graft you in. A lot of brothers are in that Gentile mind state willingly. They don't want to be a part of the body. That's why when you try to attach them with something that's righteous, there's conflict and turmoil because they're in wickedness. This is Romans 8 and 15. Romans 8 and 15. It says, for ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, that old law, that old Mosaic law, everything being punishable by death pretty much. It says, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father, screaming out to the Most High. The Spirit itself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of the Most High. And if children, then heirs of the Most High, and joint heirs with Christ or Hamashiach, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. And the brothers and sisters, a part of the body, are suffering for Yahweh Shai because a lot of men don't understand the message and don't want to understand the message. Too caught up in their carnality. They're caught up in the old man, the old ways. And haven't prayed for that understanding that Yahweh Shai came down here and put in the earth. And if a brother or a sister out there believes in Hamashiach and they're doing with the will of the Father, then they are a part of the body. They don't have to be a part of your cult or your sect or your group. And if you don't accept them as that, then you're a liar. And you hate your brother and you're a murderer, like the scriptures say. This is Colossians 1 and 2. Colossians 1 and 2. It says, to the saints and faithful brethren in Christ or Hamashiach who are at Colossae, grace be unto you and peace from our power, the Father, our Father, and the Lord, Yahawashah Hamashiach. We give thanks to the Most High and pray to our Lord, Yahawashah Hamashiach, praying always for you. And as a nation, we got to pray for each other. That's a commandment for us to love each other and to pray for each other. Brothers want to send up curses, talk about who's the elect and who's the two-thirds. We don't know. We just supposed to be faithful and loyal servants to the Heavenly Father. We don't know who's going to make it and who's not. So by you casting judgment, well, the Most High might cause you to fall into a delusion and you be destroyed. Being humble and being meek is a major part of this thing. Brothers don't want to be humble and brothers don't want to be meek. You can see it on brother's spirit. You can hear what comes out of their mouth, what the things that they type from their fingertips. You can tell who's clearly the wicked. And you can tell the brothers that and the sisters that want to be righteous. But we supposed to show that same amount of love to all, because some brothers are lost. They really on the wrong path and don't know. Just like at one point I was lost, I'll be talking down on certain men. Once the Most High woke me up, I had to go to those same men and ask for forgiveness, because I know I had transgressed against them and against the Heavenly Father. But a lot of brothers go to sleep every night and every day adding sin onto sin and not realizing it because they're in darkness. So we have to show them that love. Like the scriptures say, forgive them for they know not what they do. A lot of brothers are walking in darkness. All we got to do is keep shining that light and hopefully they wake up. Those who are set up to, and those who are not, well, you serving them up for a sore destruction by you doing the right thing, and they continue to recompense your good with evil, or show you hate while you're showing them love. This is 1 Peter 2 and 9. 1 Peter 2 and 9. It says, "But ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, and holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into the marvelous light, which in time past were not a people, but are now the people of the Most High, which had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy." So because we've been shown mercy by the Heavenly Father, we're supposed to be passing that on through the nation. We've got a lot of brothers and sisters in ill conditions because of the curses that were put on the generations of Israel. Brothers and sisters getting caught up in a drug epidemic that happened from the 70s, the 80s, and the 90s. You see the lack of family unity because of the curses of being in this cursed land, America. How our families have been split up, separated, going all the way back to slavery when we came on here through these ships. A lot of our families were split up, so that transferred generationally. A lot of brothers and sisters lacked the unity because it was put in us. That curse was put on us through bloodshed, and so it translated through the years. We got relatives and family members that cross paths today and kill each other and don't even know that they're a family member, they're part of the same body. Because Satan rules this earth, and he rules it by hate. And so our people perpetuate the same schools of thought and institution that was put on us. We're institutionalized. Israel has been institutionalized satanically. We got to come out of that web. This is Malachi 3 and 17. Malachi 3 and 17. It says, "And they shall be mine, saith the Lord of hosts, in that day when I make up my jewels, and I will spare them as a man spareth his own son that serveth him. Then ye shall return and discern between the righteous and the wicked, between him that serveth the Most High and him that serveth thee not." And the Most High is collecting, he's harvesting and getting all his children ready, those that are ready, getting ready for that marriage. Everybody's getting their oil prepared, getting everything prepared, because we're in the times of tribulation and soon to be in the time of salvation. So brothers and sisters, it would behoove you to be in the spirit of getting right and being prepared for that day. So you know that feeling of being unprepared, whether you got to take a test or you got to show up somewhere and be on time, and you're not prepared, then you late, you stressing, you out of order, there's no clarity. We're supposed to be getting right. This is the time for us to get right. And that spirit of Satan is heavy on our people. All you want to do is bicker and go back and forth, be crabs in a bucket. but you don't got your eye on the prize, which is salvation. Purifying and getting your spirit purified so it will be worthy and meet for that salvation. This is Deuteronomy 7 and 6. Go back to the old days. It says, "For thou art an holy people unto the Lord thy power." See, as a whole nation, we were set up to be a holy people. We've been weakened and compromised through these years of all of these different captivities because of the rebellion. Us always rebelling against the Heavenly Father, and He having to jack us up. "The Lord thy power hath chosen thee to be a special people unto Himself above all people that are upon the face of the earth. The Lord did not set His love upon you, nor choose you because you were more in number than any people, for you were the fewest of all people. But because the Lord loved you, and because the Lord would keep the oath which He hath sworn unto your fathers, hath the Lord brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you out of the house of bondmen from the hand of the Pharaoh, king of Egypt." So the Most High has saved us. He's put us in captivities, but He's also saved us to show us that His promises and His covenants are true and real. And brothers have spat in the Lord's face time after time, not wanting to do what they know is right, which is serve the Heavenly Father and abhor evil and abhor sin. Totally just avoid it. He's made us better than everybody, and we don't want to act like it. We want to keep up with the Joneses. This is Exodus 19 and 5. It says, "Now therefore, if you will obey my voice indeed and keep my covenant, then ye shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people, for all the earth is mine, and ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and an holy nation. These are the words which thou shalt speak unto my children, unto the children of Israel." And we were set up to be a holy people, but guess what? We took off our crowns to put on rags, just like the heathen nations. Most High has given us the silver spoon, and we threw that down for the BPA plastic. Brothers don't want to be masterful in a nation of great people, because the spirit of Satan has seduced our people to rebel and to come against the righteous order that the Most High set up for us, which was perfection. This is 2 Samuel 2 Samuel 7 and 24. "For thou hast confirmed to thyself thy people Israel to be a people unto thee forever, and thou, Lord, art become their power." Yeah, so we were supposed to be, you know, that the Most High's favorite. We were supposed to stay up under his orders and his will. But like I said, because we rebelled, the Most High jacked us up. The precept to back that up is 1 Chronicles 17 and 22. "For thy people Israel didst thou make thine own people forever, and thou, Lord, becamest their power." And we were supposed to have a kingdom that was established that would reign forever, but that's just the way Jake is, man. Jake is hard-headed. Jake want to work harder, not smarter. Be counterproductive to his own well-being. This is Ephesians 1 and 14. It says, I'll start at 13. Ephesians 1 and 13. "In whom ye also trusted, after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also, after that ye believed, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise." So like I said, brothers and sisters, all we had to do was hear that word and we were sealed. And it didn't have to come from no man. It could have come from you hearing the word as a child, you reading this book. So everybody want to go to that the Ethiopian and Philip when he said, how should thou learn unless the man teach you? That don't apply to everybody. That was a particular situation. The Ethiopian wasn't going to get it without Philip teaching it to him. That was just the way the Most High set up that man's story. But for other brothers, man, the Holy Spirit can deal with you and reveal the truth to you in a dream. Can have you stumble upon the word or have you hear it somewhere. And your spirit just agrees and understands. It says, which is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession unto the praise of his glory. So we know that we haven't been redeemed yet, so we're supposed to still be in that hopeful state of trying to get it right. Being prideful ain't gonna get us nowhere but in more hell. Being envious and hateful and spiteful to your brethren are only gonna cause more punishments. Jake don't care about punishments, he's just like a bad kid that do the bad deed and don't care about the consequences later. That's Jake, man. That's Jake. This is Hebrews 11 and 25. Hebrews 11 and 25. It says, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of the Most High than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. So yeah, you should be trying to go through what you got to go through, being tried as gold in the fire with the meek and with the children of Israel, than trying to live it up and laugh it up being some Pharisee or being like these heathen nations. Because we have to suffer to inherit the kingdom of heaven. That's one of the caveats of getting the kingdom, is we're going to have to suffer a bit. And by suffer, that means you got to go to work. You got to have a boss over you, a master. You have to have a master over you in your employment. You get ailments. You can't deal directly with the Heavenly Father. We're at a distance right now. And we don't have our unity amongst the nation. You don't have a people. See, all these nations, they have people to deal with. When I go to work in the lunchroom every day, there's different heathen nations. They all congregate together and have like a pretty much a big buffet of lunch. Everybody comes in and brings in food. But it's a certain unity, that countryman unity that these nations have that our people lack. Meanwhile, if you see two Jakes walking down the street and they pass each other by, they may not even say hi to each other. They look at each other like as enemies. And those because of the curses that was sent upon our people for having that hate in the past, for hating the Lord and hating yourself and hating your brother. Now your children's children's children are in that same vibration of hating each other. Go to Matthew's 12:46. Matthew 12:46. It says, while he yet talked to the people, behold, his mother and his brethren stood without, desiring to speak with him. Then one said unto him, behold, thy mother and thy brethren stand without, desiring to speak with thee. But he answered and said unto him that told him, who is my mother and who is my brethren? And he stretched forth his hand towards his disciples and said, behold, my mother and my brethren. For whoso shall do the will of my Father which is in heaven, the same as my brother and sister and mother. So, because a guy doesn't agree with your man-made doctrine, long as he believes in these scriptures and he's doing the will of the Heavenly Father, he's actually your brother. That means that he's a part of the body. That means that he's your neighbor. That means that he's a part of the brotherhood, so you have to treat him a certain type of way. Because a guy is not a part of your affiliation or gang or cult that you're in. By you treating him as an enemy, you're bringing curses upon yourself. You're being wicked. Unless he's coming with a doctrine that's contrary to the word, in this day and age, we're not supposed to be bickering back and forth about a new moon. We're not supposed to be bickering back and forth about who's celebrating this high holy day right on this day. We're not supposed to be bickering about that. What we're supposed to be trying to get right is the fact that Yahweh Shai came down, he died for our sins, and now we have a chance at obtaining the kingdom of heaven now. That we no longer have to be stoned because we went off in the law. That we no longer have to atone and sacrifice animals for our sins. Yahweh Shai atones for our sins. We're no longer under that bondage of that first agreement, that covenant that we had. Now Yahweh Shai has came to take down the partitions and that dividing wall that we had up in our nation. Now when you see a brother from a different land, you don't have to view him as an enemy or as an unclean heathen. He's your brother now. You can take him in and embrace him. Yahweh Shai came down to institute and establish unity. The separation is going to happen when brothers ain't doing the will of the Heavenly Father. That's when the separations come in. Or when you have a Pharisaical brotherhood separating and causing division amongst the church and amongst the nation. So yeah, I'm going to go to 1 Corinthians 12 and 27. This is 1 Corinthians 12 and 27. It says, now ye are the body of Christ, our Hamashiach, and members in particular. And the Most High hath set some in the church, first apostles, secondarily prophets, thirdly teachers, after that miracles, then gifts of healings, helps, governments, diversities of tongues. Are all apostles, are all prophets, are all teachers, are all workers of miracles, have all the gifts of healing, do all speak with tongues, do all interpret, but covet earnestly the best gifts, and yet show I unto you a more excellent way. And that more excellent way is the way of love and mercy and kindness amongst the brotherhood. You got guys out there that's saying that you soft, or you, they talk down on you because you actually practicing the qualities that the gospel shall institute inside of a person. You showing the fruits of the spirit, and now you look down upon and you hate it and you're ridiculed and mocked. But those are the sufferings that are worthy that the scriptures talk about we must endure. Brothers and sisters got to understand, when you actually doing the right thing, Satan is going to hate on you. Satan is going to jump on men and women, people in your surroundings, to hate on you. That's just the way it has to happen. This is Romans 12 and 4. Romans 12 and 4 says, for as we have many members in one body, and all members have not the same office, so we being many are one body in Christ, or in Hamashiach, and every one member have another. Having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us, whether prophecy, let us prophesy according to the proportion of faith. Our ministry, let us wait on our ministering. Or he that teacheth on teaching. Or he that exhorteth on exhortation. He that giveth, let him do it with simplicity. He that ruleth with diligence. He that showeth mercy with cheerfulness. Let love be without dissimulation. Abhor with that which is evil. Cleave to that which is good. Be kindly affectioned one to another with brotherly love, and honoring, preferring one another. And we're supposed to prefer our people. You got guys that are going to say that I hate Jake more than the other nations. I hate Israel. I can't stand these niggas more than other nations, which is wicked and is blasphemy. Because brothers shouldn't be in the spirit of hating Jake. Even though we're a very simple people in this day and time, we still have to show that love, because one day we're going to be all broken back up, brought back up. You dig? This is 1 Corinthians 12 and 12. It says, "For as the body is one and hath many members, and all the members of that one body being many are one body, so also is Christ our Mashiach. For by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, and have been all made to drink in one Spirit, into one Spirit. For the body is not one member, but many." And that's how the body or the nation is set up right now, is we're many members. You got different sets of brothers set up, different sets of sisters set up for different dealings with the nation. And until we unify and bring it all together, then we're not going to be operating in unison. And that's why there's so much disorder, because at the top levels of governing bodies are men who are set up in leadership positions. They're here with the spirit of separation, man. And it's satanic and masonic in nature, like I said, because that's the way of the world, to have infighting and to have different sects set up to go against each other to keep that satanic vibration going on. I'm gonna go to Galatians 3 and 26. This is Galatians 3 and 26. I'll start at 26. "For ye are all the children of the Most High by faith in Christ Jesus, our Mashiach Yahushai. For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ, our Mashiach, have put on a Mashiach of Christ." So, you don't know who or what a brother is just by looking at him. You don't know if a brother or a sister ain't right just by looking at him. You don't know if the Most High has chosen and sealed them for salvation. So you're not supposed to deal on that discretionary level of telling brothers that you're looking at them and you can see they're not right. Let the Most High be the judge of that, because you might not be right. You might just be drunken in pride thinking that you're doing the right thing, but the Most High set you up to be wicked. This is Ephesians 4 and 16. Ephesians 4 and 16. "From whom the whole body fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplieth, according to the effectual working and the measure of every part, making increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in love." And yeah, we're supposed to be multiplying and edifying with love. And what better counsel to have than that of a brotherhood? Got all this separation, everybody's gonna feel a different way, but when brothers came together in unity under that spirit, the Most High Spirit will reside, and there would come a better order. But every man thinking that he's right in his own mind and heart and leading other men, well, you got a million different chiefs and not enough Indians, not enough people ready to serve and do the will of the Heavenly Father. This is Romans 12 and 16. Romans 12 and 16. It says, "Be of the same mind one toward another. Mind not high things, but condescend to men of low estate. Be not wise in your own conceits. Recompense no man evil for evil. Provide things honest in the sight of all men. If it be possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceable with all men." Brothers ain't acting like that. You got guys who can't keep the next brother or the next camp name out their mouth, talking in a bad light when that brother has not offended you or did anything wrong against you, or even against the Most High. A lot of brothers have these little quarrels because of their own conceits and their own personal counsels that they've counseled in their own mind with Satan. Brothers ain't showing that real love, man. gonna go to Colossians. Colossians 3 and 11. It says, where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcision nor uncircumcision, barbarian, Scythian, bond nor free, but HaMashiach is all and in all. So if a person got the Spirit of the Lord on them, who are you to tell them that they off or they wicked, or that they not a part of the body, or we not dealing with you, not a brother? Well, you being just divisive and you being highly satanic. That's the spirit of Satan on you. And it's evident that a lot of brothers have the spirit of Satan on them. It's 1 Corinthians 12 and 13. 1 Corinthians 12 and 13. For by one spirit are we all baptized into one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, and have been all made to drink into one spirit. For the body is not one member, but many. If the foot shall say, because I am not the hand, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? And if the ear shall say, because I am not not the eye, am I not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? If the whole body were an eye, where were the hearing? If the whole were hearing, where were the smelling? But now the Most High set the members of every one of them in the body as it had pleased Him. And if they were all one member, where were the body? But now are they many members, but yet one body. I cannot say unto the hand, I have no need of thee, nor again to the head, to the feet, I have no need of you. Nay, much more are those members of the body which seem to be more feeble are necessary, and those members of the body which we think to be less honorable, upon these we bestow more abundant honor, and our uncomely parts have more abundant comeliness. For our comely parts have no need, but God hath tempered the body together, having given more abundant honor to that part which is lacked, that there should be no schism in the body, but that the members should have the same care one for another. And whether one member suffer, all the members suffer with it. Or one member be honored, all the members rejoice with it. So we're supposed to be dealing like that, bearing each other's burdens and infirmities, being brotherly and sisterly toward each other, taking care of the old and the fatherless, the widows. You got bros out here saying they hate old people, they want to kill off the elderly of Israel. How wicked is that? It's wicked as hell, man. This is Isaiah 34. Isaiah 34 and 16. It says, seek ye out of the book of the Lord and read. No one of these shall fail you. None shall want her mate. For my mouth it hath commanded, and his spirit it hath gathered them. So the spirit of the Lord gathered up these men and women together. You don't know who the Lord is going to bring into this thing. And it's not up to you to separate those which the Most High has enlightened and has imparted into the faith. A lot of brothers have driven away men away from the brotherhood, not outside of the faith, but they've driven men from out of brotherhoods, and the Most High sees that. And there's a punishment for doing that when you're actually in the wrong. You shouldn't be so quick to try to cut off members of the body that you don't know what the Most High has planned for them. This is Ephesians 2 and 22. It says, in whom ye also are builded together for an habitation of the Most High through the Spirit. And the Most High has built us up individually and as a body together, so that we can be a habitation or an environment for the Most High to dwell in. Most High dwells amongst Israel. We're the apple of His eye, and we We're how he operates on the earth. We're instituting, when we go around and promote the word and the laws and the will of the Heavenly Father, we're acting as ambassadors, our representatives of the Most High. You dig? This is Acts 4 and 32. Acts 4 and 32. Acts 4 and 32 says, "And the multitude of them that believed were of one heart and of one soul. Neither said any of them that aught of the things which he possessed was his own, but they had all things in common." And that's how Israel's supposed to be. We're supposed to have all things in common. Not necessarily just going into the physical things, because this was a certain situation and instant. But in, as far as our goals, our life goals, we should all be trying to serve the Father and at this point receive salvation. And we know that some are not. And to those that ain't in that spirit, will you let them be? Like the scriptures say, he that is unjust, let him be unjust still. You can't drag a person across the finish line if they don't want to cross the finish line. This is Ephesians 4 and 4. It says, "There is one body and one spirit, even as ye were called, and one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one power, and Father of all, who is above all, and through all, and in you all. But unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of the Mashiach." So, those who are of the body, we're given grace, man. And who are you to try to take that grace and rush that grace and affect that grace that this man has been given? See, brothers got to humble down and know how to be meek with this thing. As fishermen, you're supposed to be fishing. You're not supposed to be ripping fish out of the water, shooting fish, electrocuting fish. You're supposed to be fishing. In ancient times, men would be such good fishermen, a lot of times most of the fish would still be alive when they were selling the fish. You didn't even have to kill it. You're such a skilled fisherman. You wouldn't even, a good fisherman, you don't even mess up the when you're fishing a fish, you don't even mess up the fish that bad. You might pull the hook out and that fish be good as new still. But then you got brothers who are spear fishing, and they kill the fish and stick a spear halfway through it and ruin the meat. Not very good fishermen. Because you were taught how to fish incorrectly. Hebrews 10 and 24 says, "And let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as ye see the day approaching." So yeah, that doesn't sound like cussing somebody out. Steadily rebuking somebody, exhorting somebody in love, treating them like you want to be treated. That's something that a lot of men ain't doing. And a lot of men don't want that great multitude of Israel to make it into the kingdom. They only want a select few. They only want about 500 dudes that they know are cool with to make it. They want everybody else to die and to suffer. They want to see the blood of their nation flow unjustly. And for that, the Most High will return that upon your head. Go to 1 Peter 3 and 8, and I'm almost done, I'm going to wrap it up. 1 Peter 3 and 8, it says, "Finally, be ye all of one mind, having compassion one of another, Love as brethren. Be pitiful. Be courteous. Not rendering evil for evil or railing for railing, but contrariwise blessing. Knowing that ye are unto called that ye should inherit a blessing. For ye that will love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil and his lips that they speak no guile. Let him eschew evil and do good. Let him speak peace and ensue it. And a lot of brothers ain't speaking peace, and they're not refraining their lips. Their lips is like a wildfire, going from house to house, burning it down. And Jake don't see no wrong in it, because you in that blindness, you dark, you in the darkness. Like a blind person, who, like a bull in a china shop, just you blind and you knocking everything over. That's how brothers is putting this word out. You're not doing a good enough job at it. You're not taking this thing seriously. You going into the bandwagon cult mind state of just getting along and doing what you see the others do. As leaders of this nation, we have to have courage enough to tap the next leader and tell him, hey brother, that's not what the scripture said. That's not the way we're supposed to be doing these things. A lot of brothers just want to cuss each other out and go back and forth like that's the end goal. The end goal is for us to inherit the kingdom. And there's only one way that we're going to do that, serving the Lord righteously and in unity. Not hating on your brother. If you hate your brother, man, you hate yourself, you hate the Most High. A lot of brothers ain't gonna understand that till they come full circle, though. This is 1 Corinthians 10 and 24. It says, let no man seek his own, but every man another's wealth. Whatsoever is sold in the shambles that eat, asking no questions for conscience sake. For the earth is the Lord's, and the fullness thereof. And if any of them that believe not bid you to a feast, and ye be disposed to go, whatsoever is set before you to eat, asking no questions for conscience sake. But the point is let no man seek his own, but every man another's wealth. And that's helping each other out. That's helping out the brotherhood and the elderly and the fatherless. That's not just giving your money to some leaders or elders. It's a nation thing. What scriptures told you to forget about the whole nation and just focus on some elders? What scripture is that? Because the scriptures tell us to take care of the fatherless, the widows, those who are without, those who need to hear the word, the sick. There's no age limit or age gap on age cap on that. I'm gonna go ahead and finish it off with this scripture and let brothers be gone. But this is Philippians 1 and 27. It says, only let your conversation be as it becometh the gospel of Christ, or the gospel of HaMashiach, that whether I come and see you or else be absent, I may hear of your affairs, that ye stand fast in one spirit, with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel, and in nothing terrified by your adversaries, which is them an evident token of perdition, but to you of salvation, and that of the Most High. And I'm going to go ahead and say, Barakatah Yahweh Bashem Yahashai, Shalom. Barakatah Yahweh Bashem Yahashai to those who received the message, those who were edified, those who are in the correct spirit of the doctrine of the Bible, not these man-made doctrines and commandments of men. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord work on you. May the Lord help you grow. May the Lord bless the increase of your understanding, faith, and of your family. May the Lord bless and increase the love in your heart and your spirit. May the Lord work on you so that you could be a vessel to do the will of the Heavenly Father, to help usher in the kingdom of heaven. May the Lord guide you and keep you pure from all the evil and wickedness and darkness that surrounds us. May the Lord keep you close. May you be well and be at peace and be blessed through HaMashiach Yahweh Shai. Peace and blessings. Shalom.